I really got into skating in a big way when I was about 11 years old. And the moment when I knew I wanted to skate and not do other sports was the first time I went to a skate park and saw people flying out of pools. All my life, I was trying to find a buzz, and I didn't really get it from team sports. I was okay at baseball and basketball, but I wasn't improving at a rate I could see. And then when I went to the skate park for the first time, I literally saw these guys going into a pool and flying, and I was like, that's it. And then I started trying to figure out how to do that. I did it in the little pools. I saw a picture of Steve Caballero, who was about my size, but just a little bit older, and he was doing an air in Winchester, like 3 or 4 feet out. I saw these guys, they were older and more experienced doing these things, and it looked intimidating, but it looked awesome. When I saw Steve Caballero, he was my size, near my age, and he was literally flying. And I was like, if he can do it, I can do that. I know I may not do it as well as him or with as much style, but I'm gonna learn how to do that. And that was the moment. That was the moment when I decided I was gonna do that. Because I did like that it was made me different, and that it was something that I identify myself with. And it's made me stand apart from everyone else I went to school with. Most other kids my age, I did appreciate that. But at the same time, I always wondered, well, why don't they like this? This is amazing. Like, it's super difficult. It's adrenaline filled. It's dangerous. There's a sense of accomplishment. What are they missing about this? And it just never really hit in those days. And so, yeah, I guess I would be the one to either blame or credit for doing mainstream stuff. And hopefully making it acceptable or making it authentic. To be honest, that happened because I lived through the 80s and I made all my biggest mistakes in the 80s. And I thank God there was no TMZ or YouTube or any of that stuff because I signed my rights away to a few companies. I didn't have control over my name or likeness, and they started blasting stuff out that was just garbage, junk with my name on it, and I had no recourse. And like I said, it was the 80s. Skating wasn't as big as it is now, and things were kind of forgiven back then, especially attire and stuff like that. And so when I had the chance to do it again, I got a second career for the most part because of X Games and skating's cyclical popularity. And as it came back around, I was still kind of riding high, I was still skating well, and they wanted to do more vert contests, so I still had my vert skills, and I jumped back into the competitions, and I was doing well, and I had a new opportunity to do promotions and do endorsements and things like that. And I definitely walked the line. I was doing stuff like Club Med and Bagel Bites and McDonald's, and of course I got a lot of flack for big endorsements. I mean, people were calling me Bagel Boy for a while. And the thing is that when people hear, "Oh, he sponsored by McDonald's," sellout. You're a sellout. That's it, case closed. You don't get any recourse. And people were like, "How could you be sponsored by McDonald's?" And I'm like, "I've been eating McDonald's since I was a kid. Like, I still eat it. I'm not sponsored by it anymore. I still eat it. It's congruent with my beliefs. Like, it doesn't change who I am. It's not like I'm changing all my morals so that I get paid." And I've turned stuff down. I mean, there was a tour. I'm not going to name names, but there was a tour a long time ago sponsored by a tobacco company. And I refused it. Woo! Stood my ground, but it just seems absurd to me that I would go promote a cigarette company. That's crazy. I've never changed my value system for money, ever. To be honest, like McDonald's, they committed a large amount of money to the foundation through my association with them. So through my endorsement with McDonald's, I was able to build more public skate parks. I was able to promote skating through marketing money that we would never have seen in the skateboard industry, endemic to our sports. So, the fact that I got to show skateboarding to a whole new audience of people that are watching whatever that see a McDonald's commercial come on with skateboarding, that may inspire them to start skating. I mean, that's always my motivation, is just to represent skating well and to possibly get more people involved in it. I think it's just more that people are looking for you to somehow misrepresent skateboarding. And when they see that, then that's when they get really fired up. I mean, definitely they have their knee-jerk reaction that, well, you can't be sponsored by this company because they don't, they're not from skateboarding. They don't represent skateboarding. Like that argument doesn't work anymore because most skateboard companies are just owned by some bigger corporation that probably didn't have anything to do with skateboarding when they started. You know, that's just how it is now. Everything was just getting eaten up and eaten up. I say if you're representing skateboarding in a positive light, you're doing it right. And if you're using someone else's marketing dollars to do so, more power to you. You know, like we did Tony Hawk's Pro Skater. I signed a contract. I had no idea that that would be a big game or a game that would sell at all. I just wanted skaters to be proud of it. So I set out to, you know, make the tricks authentic, make the locations fun, make the challenges something that skaters would and get a group of skaters that are well respected from and make it very diverse. And so what I set out to do was say the first video game was something that I thought would inspire skaters to buy a PlayStation. That was all I had in my head, was like, skaters are going to dig this so much, they're going to play video games. And as it turned out, you know, it became this huge success. It changed my life completely. And with every succeeding game, we tried to build upon that and bring in more people from the skate culture, but still represent it well. And I'm hugely proud of it. And I don't really need the money. Like, I don't need the money anymore. I made dream money from video games, like stuff that I, things I would never imagine. You know, when people say like, is this what you dreamt? I didn't dream any of this. None of this was possible or even considered a reality when I was a kid. You know, when I started skating, like the best you could hope for was your picture in a magazine, maybe a pro board, maybe, and free gear. That's it. And then once you reach an age of responsibility, and this is, I'm talking about when I was like 12, once you reach an age of responsibility, say 18, your career is over because you're not, you can't make money doing it. You can't do it into your adult life. The jury's out, obviously, still, of like, well, are you a sellout? What is the, you know, Mountain Dew, this, like GoPro, Nike. Hey, all these guys still love skating. They're not changing what they do because they have a Mountain Dew sticker on their board. You know what I mean? If anything, it's allowing them to do it better and to a bigger audience. And maybe, you know, not have to find a job elsewhere. Like, I had to supplement my income when things were rough, like doing video editing. You know, I was literally like, I had video editing equipment. And when things took a downturn in skating, like, I was editing videos for Tumietto and actually for like a video game company. Like, how ironic, actually. I'd never thought about that, that I was doing video editing for TurboGrafx, and then I ended up getting a video game myself. And what I learned through that is that as a skater, as someone who lives in this world and knows the authenticity of it and the culture of it and has respect for it and wants to keep its integrity, I told them, look, you can't put anything out there without my approval. Doesn't matter if it's even, you know, it's my whatever, if I'm attached to it, I have final say over it. And I had to fight for that. I had to fight for it a lot, you know. And eventually, as skating grew and as people started to respect it more, I didn't have to fight for it as much. And at some point, I was like, look, I've had signature equipment with my name on it since I was 14 years old, right? It was not selling. So it certainly wasn't selling out. And so what I've learned through this, and I'm sure people have heard me say it before, you only get called a sellout when people buy your stuff. You know, you get called a sellout when your stuff finally sells. That's it. Like, and is that bad? Like, do you think that I've changed my tune or my motivation because I make money? Hell no. Look, this ramp right here cost me $600,000 right here. And it is my best thing I've ever bought. I skate this thing almost every day, you know, and it really has been one of the best things in my life. Like, just the fact that I still get to skate. Obviously, I'm hugely thankful to still be able to do this for a living. Like, this is what I love doing more than anything. And I would do it for free. Like, any day of the week, you know, at any given time, I'd happily just go skate. It just happens to be the thing that I'm successful at. So I get to do what I love for a living, and that's living the dream. I mean, and living the dream, I'm not talking about financial success. I'm talking about loving what you do. You know, if you love art and you do art and maybe you get a little bit of success at it, you're living the dream. I know there are so many kids out there that feel the way that I did when I was a kid, just awkward and not excelling at one thing in particular and not cool. And skateboarding was my way out of that. And I hope that if not with skateboarding, they find it in something else they do. But I hope that they're not afraid to try something different, because you can't listen to the haters. That's my best advice to anyone. If I had listened to the haters, I would have quit a long time ago. I would have quit when I was 11 years old. Like, I used to get bashed by professional skaters because my style was dorky, or it was all circus. It was, you know. But you can't. You've got to believe in yourself. Skateboarding has given me a sense of identity, a sense of self-confidence. It's given me an unbelievable career. It's given me a way to provide for my family, and it's given me opportunities I never dreamed of. Traveling the world, meeting incredible people, going to events, you know, stuff that just never seemed possible. And every day there's a new surprise. You know, I still am, stuff is happening that I can't believe that I get to participate in. But for me, you know, it just gave me my voice. And I was a pretty scrawny kid that was unsure of himself and trying to fit in. And it gave me this unique voice and a way to express myself like nothing else.